Ben Franklin's World is a production of the Omohundro Institute. Did you know that Ben Franklin's World now has its own Amazon Alexa skill? Alexa, enable Ben Franklin's World.
Okay, here's Ben Franklin's World. Welcome.
This means you can now listen to Ben Franklin's World on your Amazon smart speaker and tell it to do things like play your favorite episode. Alexa, tell Ben Franklin's World to play episode 130.
Here's 130 Paul Revere's Ride Through History, Doing History Rev.
Support for Ben Franklin's World and the Doing History to the Revolution series comes from the Omohundro Institute of Early American History and Culture.
You can tell it to rewind to your favorite part. Alexa, tell Ben Franklin's World to rewind 10 minutes.
Skipping backward 10 minutes.
From the public memory so much that it's kind of a self-perpetuating.
Or you can tell it to stop playing the podcast so you can go do something else and then have it resume right where you left off when you're ready to listen again. Alexa, stop.
Okay, come back anytime to listen to your podcast. You just have to say, Alexa, resume.
So, if you have an Amazon smart speaker, just tell it, Alexa, enable Ben Franklin's World. And now, on with the show.
Welcome to Ben Franklin's World, a podcast about early American history with Liz Covart. The study of history is key to understanding who we are and how we can affect a better future. Ben Franklin's World will introduce you to historical people and events that have impacted and shaped our present-day world. And now, here's your host, Liz Covart.
Hello, and welcome to episode 181 of Ben Franklin's World, the podcast dedicated to helping you learn more about how the people and events of our early American past have shaped the present-day world we live in. Why did Americans choose to become patriots or loyalists during the American Revolution? How did they actually make their decision to stand either with or against their neighbors? Did political beliefs really drive them to support one side over the other? Today, we're going to explore answers to these questions about how and why Americans chose to support the sides they did during the American Revolution by looking at the lives of two young soldiers from Connecticut. Moses Dunbar, a young man who chose to support the British Crown by joining and recruiting for Edmund Fanning's Loyalist Regiment, and Nathan Hale, a young man who chose to support the revolutionaries by joining Connecticut and Continental units. Now, taking us through the lives, politics, and decisions of these young men is Virginia DeJohn Anderson, a professor of history at the University of Colorado-Boulder and author of The Martyr and the Traitor, Nathan Hale, Moses Dunbar, and the American Revolution. Now, as we explore the lives of both Dunbar and Hale, Virginia reveals biographical details about Moses Dunbar and Nathan Hale, information about the political atmosphere in Connecticut, both before and during the American Revolution, and details about what drove Moses Dunbar and Nathan Hale to support the imperial and revolutionary causes during the American Revolution. But first, just a reminder that this coming Saturday, April 14, we will be meeting up in Sacramento, California. We'll meet at 4 p.m. at the Firestone Public House on 16th Street in downtown Sacramento. And if you can't make that meetup, we're also meeting up on Saturday, April 21st at 4 p.m. in the lobby of the Wyndham Grand Desert Hotel in Las Vegas. Now, I've included a link to both the Firestone Public House and the Wyndham Grand Desert Hotel in the show notes. Or you can email me, liz@benfranklinsworld.com, if you have any questions or need further information about these meetups. I really look forward to meeting you in Sacramento and Las Vegas, and honestly, I can't wait, because these meetups are always a lot of fun. Okay, are you ready to explore the lives and decisions of Nathan Hale and Moses Dunbar? Allow me to introduce you to our guest historian.
With tidings and wisdom to share about our early American past, here is this week's special guest.
Our guest is a professor of history at the University of Colorado-Boulder. She's the author of three books. The first two, New England's Generation and Creatures of Empire, focused on the 17th century history of early America, while her latest book, an award-winning book, The Martyr and the Traitor, Nathan Hale, Moses Dunbar, and the American Revolution, brings us into the 18th century. Welcome to Ben Franklin's World, Virginia DeJohn Anderson.
Oh, thank you.
Now, in The Martyr and the Traitor, Virginia tells the stories of Nathan Hale and Moses Dunbar, two men who were sentenced to hang for their loyalties and actions during the Revolutionary War. Virginia, I wonder if we could start with you telling us a bit about both Nathan Hale and Moses Dunbar, and why you chose to write a book about their lives and experiences.
The origins of this book
actually lie in an undergraduate paper I wrote many years ago at the University of Connecticut. It was a paper on loyalism in Connecticut, and in the course of the research I did, I discovered this fugitive anecdote about Moses Dunbar being the only Connecticut inhabitant convicted of treason by a civil court. Now, there were people convicted by courts martial, but by a civil court convicted of treason against the state of Connecticut and executed. And so I always wondered, why was he the only one? And when I finally came around to deciding to work on the book, it occurred to me that there was another individual in Connecticut who chose the opposite side in the revolution and was executed, albeit in different circumstances, by the British Army. And that looking at these two individuals in tandem who will come to a bad end in the revolution might tell us something about ordinary lives during the revolution and how people came to choose the side they did.
It must have been really interesting to compare and contrast the lives of Moses Dunbar and Nathan Hale, as they did make opposite decisions about their loyalties and yet also had very similar experiences during the revolution.
Yeah, they're both from farming families in Connecticut. The bulk of Connecticut settlers were farmers in this period. So there seemed to be sort of a certain similarity in their beginnings, although the Hale family was more prosperous than the Dunbar family. So the question was, why do these two farm boys take opposite sides? What leads them in these different directions?
Now, you mentioned that both Nathan Hale and Moses Dunbar were from the colony of Connecticut. And I wonder if you would tell us a bit about what Connecticut was like on the eve of the revolution, because that was the world that both Hale and Dunbar came of age in.
Okay, what's interesting about Connecticut is that it was probably the most homogeneous in terms of its social background, the demographic structure of the population, the economic background, probably the most homogeneous, certainly the mainland colonies in the British Empire. Most of the settlers were of English extraction, generally prosperous farmers. I mean, not all of them, but studies of the economic structure in Connecticut suggest that farmers on the whole were more prosperous there than, say, in places like Massachusetts. So it seemed to me the least likely place where you might find the partisanship that I did discover over the issue of revolution. Typically, people who study this look for class differences or sort of ideological differences, and certainly there are ideological differences, but see them rooted in ethnicity or something like that that just don't exist in Connecticut. It was a pretty stable and peaceful place.
Yeah, it definitely sounds like a kind of place where you wouldn't expect revolution to happen.
Right.
Now, you mentioned that both Hale and Dunbar were the son of farmers. Would you tell us more about their childhoods?
Well, much of this is speculation based on fragmentary evidence about their fathers, their families of origin. We know that Moses' father, John Dunbar, was something of a striver. He was not very prosperous. His father was not very prosperous, but John Dunbar did want to do better for himself. He ultimately moves from his birthplace in Wallingford to Waterbury, a neighboring town, though in order to scrape together the funds with which to do that, he spends some time in the colonial army during the French and Indian War and earns a salary that way. What makes the John Dunbar family interesting is that John Dunbar does something that his father did and that his son also does, Moses, and that is get his bride pregnant out of wedlock. And in the case of John Dunbar, I believe he was 21 or so, quite young. I'm not positive on the age, but quite young, which hurt his chances of real prosperity because he, at a very young age, is going to have to support a family, children. Ultimately, the Dunbar family, I think, ends up with 14 children. The Hale family, Richard Hale is also a striver, and he's born and grows up in Newbury, Massachusetts, but it's pretty clear his father dies when he's very young, and so he's not going to get much of an estate or inheritance. So what he decides to do is look for a place where land is really quite cheap. Ends up in Coventry, Connecticut, which is a town that people had just started settling about a decade before Richard Hale gets there. So he gets in on the ground floor and ends up with something like four times as much land as John Dunbar does. And this shapes the lives of the children. Moses Dunbar is the eldest. He's not the firstborn. The first child in the family dies in infancy, so that makes Moses effectively the eldest son. So he's going to be working the hardest for his father, who is trying to scrape together a living. Richard Hale, as I say, acquires a pretty substantial estate, and he also gains contacts in Coventry. Not sure quite how he met Elizabeth Strong, but in meeting her and marrying her, he forms a family tie with one of the most prominent founding families in Coventry. So Richard has good connections. He has more land. He's a well-respected individual. He's chosen deacon of his church and ultimately becomes one of the town's representatives to the General Assembly. So again, farming families of different levels of wealth, and one becomes more politically prominent than the other.
Moses Dunbar did something that both his father and grandfather had done. He got his future wife pregnant before they were married. Would you tell us more about that particular circumstance? How did this fact impact the trajectory of Moses' life?
Okay, this was apparently not all that uncommon in the colonial period, the late colonial period, for New England young couples to start their families before they actually wed. I forget the exact number, but a substantial number of premarital pregnancies seem to have occurred. And it was less scandalous so long as the couple married, which is the case in the Dunbar family, both the grandfather, the father, and Moses. Moses was not quite 18. I don't have a firm birth date for his wife, but she seems to have been about 17. My guess is that Moses did this in part because he loved his wife, Phoebe Jerome, but also that he was chafing under his father's authority and he wanted to set out on his own. And one of the ways young men in New England could establish independence is through marriage and starting a family. I suspect he assumed that upon telling his father the news of his impending marriage, or his, what he hoped to be his impending marriage, that his father would give him land. As it turns out, his father didn't give him land for quite some time. And when he did, it was only a tiny little piece of land because John Dunbar was still working hard to support all the other children in the family. So Moses starts out this independent life as a husband and father with very, very few resources.
And yet, when we contrast this experience with the one of Nathan Hale, we find that Hale had a very different early adulthood than Moses Dunbar, even though the two were sons of Connecticut farmers. So would you tell us more about the early adulthood that Nathan Hale experienced?
Yeah, one of the surprising things, I grew up in Connecticut in Nathan Hale country, and it wasn't until I started working on this project that I realized he was actually 21 when he died. So he was very young. Hale, again, is from this relatively prosperous family, and although his father didn't go to college, there were other members of his family who had. Now, Nathan was, I believe, the fifth son in a family of 12, and although Richard Hale had a substantial amount of land, had he divided up his estate among all his male heirs, each one would have gotten a relatively small farm. So he made a choice to, in effect, give a legacy in advance to, I think it's three of his sons, certainly Nathan Hale and his brother Enoch, who was about a year older, give them their legacies in the form of a college education. And again, very small number of New England men went to college in this period, but this is what moved Nathan Hale into a different level of society, having this special education when he went to Yale in 1769.
It really sounds like this college education really separated the worlds of Moses Dunbar and Nathan Hale. I mean, Dunbar worked his farmland, but he really didn't have a lot of economic prospects. Whereas, because of his college education, it sounds like Nathan Hale had a lot of economic prospects. Is that what a college education really meant for men in colonial America? That it would automatically give them, you know, a chance to increase their economic prospects?
It could have if he had lived long enough. Certainly, it opened up all sorts of occupational possibilities, principally being a minister, being a lawyer. I mean, he would have had to have a little more training, but the Yale education was the starting point. So he could have moved off the farm into something more lucrative, certainly, and more politically prominent than anything Moses Dunbar could ever have dreamed of.
I'm actually really curious about Hale's college education, because as you mentioned, it was kind of rare for a man to go to college in colonial America. So did Hale's interactions at Yale expand his social network too? I mean, did it give him a chance to interact with other young men who he really wouldn't have interacted with during his childhood because they were in a totally different social circle?
Oh, definitely. When he gets there, his class consists mainly of other young men from Connecticut, but it includes young men, son of prominent ministers, of government officials, governors. And so he mingles with this relatively high-powered, ambitious group of young men who I think nurtured whatever incipient ambition he may have brought to Yale to make him more excited about ultimately breaking away from Coventry, Connecticut, and really making something of himself. So he definitely makes connections outside of his local community, which was hard for somebody like Dunbar to do, who is really rooted in his community.
Okay, so on the eve of the revolution, we have two young men, one who's trying to make ends meet to support his young family, and the other who's a fresh college graduate with social connections and an education that would allow him to do something more with his life than farm. So what happens to these men and their ambitions at the outbreak of the imperial crisis? Because between 1765 and 1775, the imperial crisis between Great Britain and her 13 North American colonies really expands, especially in nearby Boston, which saw riots over the Stamp Act, the Boston Tea Party, and the nearby battles of Lexington and Concord, all of which, I should mention, we've explored in episodes of this podcast. So, Virginia, what did the escalation of the imperial crisis mean for Dunbar and Hale? And in what ways did these loud and violent events in nearby Boston impact the people of Connecticut?
Well, I think what affected certainly Dunbar most was what was going on in Connecticut, more so than what was going on in Boston. The key to Dunbar's experience and his political choice is that shortly after his marriage to Phoebe Jerome, he leaves the congregational church of his own birth family and joins the Church of England. And being an Anglican in colonial Connecticut was not way out of line. I think there were something like 45 towns in Connecticut that had Anglican parishes, but through this choice of a religious affiliation, he joins a church headed by the king. And so when the Stamp Act crisis and these other events occur, they're seen as protests in part against British authority and against the king. The Anglican ministers in Connecticut were instructed to tell their parishioners, don't go to these protests, you know, lay low, don't get yourself involved in this. And although I don't know for sure, there's certainly no evidence that Dunbar got involved in any of these protests. But as we move from the early tax disputes toward the actual outbreak of war, one of the things we find in Connecticut is that those who are identified as patriots, as supporting the American cause, begin to, there's no other way to say it, intimidate and attack those who they see as not sharing their point of view. And in Connecticut, Anglicans in particular became targets. The assumption was, no matter what they did or said, because they were Anglicans, they must support the king. And I think it's this local situation of intimidation and attack. Moses Dunbar was attacked by a mob and beaten up, that helped shape his political views far beyond anything that was happening in the 13 colonies as a whole or Boston. In the case of Hale, what's interesting to me was when I figured out that his time at Yale was 1769 to 1773, which some historians call the kind of quiet period. At the beginning, the controversy over the Townsend Acts is receding, and the Townsend Acts, of course, are repealed, at least all of them, except the one on tea in 1770. And Hale graduates before the Tea Party. So he's in college at probably the least politically active time in that whole decade. And there's no evidence that he was really engaging in this at all. Now, his father at various points was the Coventry representative to the general court and hence would have been aware of these debates. And I suspect that Nathan Hale was aware of what was going on, but there's no sense in which he was really engaged. And again, he's 18, 19 years old, not of an age in 18th century society where even if he had had political opinions, anybody would have paid attention to them. Where he joins the sort of revolutionary movement is really quite late. After he graduates from college, he did what a lot of his classmates did, which is spend some time as a school teacher while he tried to figure out what he wanted to do in his life. He spends a couple of months briefly in East Haddam, Connecticut, but then moves to a job he likes much better in New London, Connecticut, at something called the Union School. The proprietors of this Union School consisted of prominent New London men, virtually all of whom were very much involved in the protests against England. And I think it's through the influence of his patrons that they were the source of his political education in thinking about matters that otherwise he would not have done. And as far as him joining the army in 1775, there seems to be at least circumstantial evidence that what was going on is Hale and his classmates were writing to each other about the impending crisis. And then as some of his classmates began joining the army, there was this contagion among the others, like if so-and-so is doing it, I should do it too. Not to say that there weren't patriotic ideals underlying this, but I think there are social factors that explain Hale's participation as well.
As Virginia mentioned at the start of our conversation, both Nathan Hale and Moses Dunbar chose to support different sides during the American Revolution. And I'd like for us to explore their decision-making processes about which side they chose to support. And since we're already on the subject of Nathan Hale, why don't we stay focused on his story for a bit? Virginia, Nathan Hale decided to join the Revolutionary Army. And it sounds like he joined because a lot of his friends were joining the army. But regardless, he joined an independent artillery company. Would you tell us about why he chose to join that particular company and what his military experience would have been like within that unit?
Okay, well, the independent artillery company had been founded in New London in 1762, at the end point of the French and Indian War. And it was really something akin to a social club in New London. You had to pay money to join. You had to get your own special uniform. And so it was essentially as much a social club as a military organization of the New London elite. Several of the members were proprietors of the Union School, and they invited Nathan Hale to join. If you were a member of this independent artillery company, your training, your drilling with that organization replaced your otherwise required participation with the regular militia of able-bodied men in the community. But it seems to have been as much a social club as anything else. It's not clear what Hale would have done there other than learning how to keep his gun clean and march around on a training field, that he didn't really get much military experience there. So it had relatively little to do with his subsequent joining of initially the Connecticut forces that were then absorbed into the Continental Army later on. We know one or two of his brothers with the Lexington alarm in 1775 did go up briefly to help defend Massachusetts. That may also have played a role in his decision later on to join the army in, I think it was July of 1775.
What's really striking to me about your descriptions is that Hale seems to have joined the army more for its social aspects than for its military ones. I mean, it sounds like Hale was more interested in hanging out with his friends than getting involved with an actual battle. Do you think that was really the case, that Hale joined the army for social reasons? Or do you think that he had some sort of economic or political ideas that would have influenced his decision to join the revolutionaries' cause?
You know, it's hard to tell. I certainly don't want to discount that he had political ideals informing him. I mean, he went to college and he read a lot of the classical literature that Bernard Balin, among others, have said, you know, were influential in forming the ideology of the revolution. He wasn't reading them for political purposes when he was in college, but those ideas certainly would have been in his mind as the revolutionary crisis escalated. We don't have any direct evidence of his political views, but as I say, I don't want to discount them because of that. I do think the social piece of this is as important, not necessarily the most important. And to understand that social piece, we need to go back to Yale and not just his membership in a college class. But while he was at Yale, he joined something called the Lenonia Society, which was in effect a literary club of young men there who were frustrated by the fact that the traditional curriculum at Yale did not allow training in English literature and belles lettres and things like that. And so they decided to form this club where they would read things, they would discuss things, they would put on plays, they would have debates, all these sorts of things. It was a kind of a boys' club, too. They seemed to have gotten a little boisterous at times. But within his larger college class, Hale formed very close connections with these fellow members of the Lenonia Society. And they had anniversary celebrations at the end of the year where they would say, you know, we must make sure we keep in touch with each other and so on. So many of those people, I found, many of his fellow Linonia Club members were joining the army at the very beginning of the revolution and going up to join the forces, the American forces, besieging Boston after Lexington conquered. And because it was a siege, a couple of things. All these college-educated young men, by virtue of their college educations, enter the army as officers. So Hale begins as a lieutenant and ultimately rises to a captain. But when they go to the siege outside Boston, a siege doesn't have a lot of military actions. And what fragmentary evidence exists from letters, and Nathan Hale kept a diary when he was in the army, because they don't have a whole lot of military stuff to do, he gets together with college classmates and they read and they play games and discuss things. And so it seems as if it was a way for him to physically get together with his friends after they had dispersed just a couple of years earlier when they graduated from college. In the intervening years, 1773 to 1775, a number of letters survive where they're writing to each other saying, I miss you, I wish I could see you, you're my best friend, and so on. So there seems to be this really sentimental connection with these young men that can be nurtured by military service. Again, I don't think that's the whole story. One other piece of Linonia society, which may be relevant here, is, as I said earlier, they put on plays and people gave speeches. We don't know the content of much of what Nathan Hale did, but we know the reaction of his fellow club members because these were recorded in the club minutes. And he was apparently a very skilled speaker and actor, performer. And when we come to his military service, I think that also plays into his desire to make something of himself, not just to be a kind of ordinary lieutenant or captain, but to excel and to gain the approbation of his friends and superiors.
Do we know if Nathan Hale proved to be an effective leader in the army, or did his units just not see enough action to determine whether he would grow into being a good leader?
He's not a very high-ranking official. He's a captain at the end. There are a couple of things that bring into question how effective a leader he may have been. While his unit was stationed outside Boston, again, evidence from his own diary suggests that now and then he was kind of fraternizing with his men, playing games and things like that, which he really probably should not have been doing. And it suggests that he saw his men as people who he wanted to take care of, but whose approval he really wanted to get as well. His unit moves to New York after the British are leaving Boston in 1776. I think it's April of 1776 when his unit heads down to New York. All we know is, again, it's fragmentary evidence that he was involved in a raid in June of 1776, where he and a group of men, they were attacking a transport that was bringing goods and supplies and men to a British warship anchored in New York Harbor. They were able to capture one of the sloops bringing supplies and bring three of the men back to the American forces for questioning. He may have led that, but we don't know for sure. He was involved in the Battle of New York, but we don't really know how much of a role he played there.
But we do know that Nathan Hale became a spy. And after we discuss our episode sponsor, I wonder if you would tell us the story of how Hale became a spy for the Continental Army. It's hard to believe, but Ben Franklin's World is now in its fourth year of production. In fact, we've spoken with over 200 historians and now have more than 180 episodes. Now, one of the best parts of producing this podcast week after week is getting to hear from you. Every week, listeners like yourself email me, post comments and ideas on the Ben Franklin's World Facebook page or in our listener community, or they tweet me, at Liz Covart. But there are thousands of you I haven't heard from yet, and everyone's voice matters. That's why the Omohundro Institute and I have put together a survey. We want to get to know you and hear what you think about the show. After all, Ben Franklin's World exists for you. The OI and I want you to enjoy discovering more about our early American past each and every week. And doing that in the most enjoyable, effective, and sustainable way possible is our number one priority. That's why I'm asking you for a big favor. Can you spare me just a few minutes to complete our online survey? We tested it in the office, and it really doesn't take more than just a few minutes to complete. Just visit benfranklinsworld.com/survey and share your thoughts with us. I know we're all busy and that taking the time to do this survey is a really big favor. Please know that your participation will really help keep the show fresh and available for download every Tuesday. Plus, everyone who completes the survey will be entered into a drawing for a signed copy of some really great books about early American history. Again, our survey is available at benfranklinsworld.com/survey. Thanks again for your help with this. I really look forward to hearing from you. Virginia, how did Nathan Hale become a spy for the Continental Army?
Okay, well, in the wake of this disastrous Battle of Long Island, disastrous for the Americans, and then their flight onto Manhattan and then up toward Harlem Heights, George Washington was desperate for information about what the British were going to do because it looked as if the revolution was going to end right there. Nathan Hale, around the time of the Battle of New York, had left his original unit in the Continental Army to join a special ranger force headed up by a guy named Thomas Knowlton, who was from Ashford, Connecticut, which is fairly near Coventry. And this was a kind of force of particularly daring men who would lead reconnaissance missions and so on. And so it was as a member of Knowlton's ranger force that Hale got involved in the spying. Washington apparently put out a request for somebody who would go to Manhattan and kind of find out what the British were doing, presumably find out how many are there, where they're stationed, where their arms are, all this sort of stuff. Now, the information we have about the process by which Hale got involved comes from a memoir of a guy named William Hull, who was one of Hale's college friends. And the story goes that when there was a request for a volunteer, Nathan Hale raised his hand. And when Hale later told Hull about this, Hull goes, no, you shouldn't do that. It's dishonorable. But Hale himself seemed to think he could pull this off. And what a great thing it would be for Washington and the Army. So again, I think there are patriotic reasons for this. But also it gave him a chance to actually do something in this war. And I think he thought he was going to succeed. And if he did, boy, you know, the stories he could tell his friends, the approbation he would gain from his superiors, he saw himself, as he said, doing more service to the country than he had been doing up to that point.
Yeah, this was, it sounds like the real opportunity that Hale was looking for to prove and make something of himself, this mission to gather intelligence for the Continental Army.
Oh, I think so. And why he thought he could do it, as someone who has spent her career teaching 20 and 21-year-old men, they seem to, students in general, kind of see themselves as invincible. And I think youth is a big piece of this, that he didn't fully consider what was going on. But the other thing, which was interesting, is the idea, and I don't know whether it was his or somebody else's, the idea was that what Nathan Hale was going to do is dress up as a schoolmaster and make his way to Long Island and just pretend he was a schoolmaster, gather the information, which he supposedly wrote in Latin on a piece of paper, which was another piece of his college education, and stuck the information in his shoes. He'd been a schoolmaster, so he knew how to pretend to be one. And I think he saw this as a kind of dramatic performance as well. And he'd been a very good actor in college. And so I think he was looking at it through the lens of his previous experience and a kind of self-confidence that perhaps only the young really have, and thought he could do it.
Do we happen to know any more about the details of Hale's intelligence gathering mission? I mean, this was the mission that led Hale to be captured and executed by the British.
Okay, well, he is sent to Long Island from the camp on Manhattan, and he crosses over Long Island Sound to Long Island. And at the time, I think the assumption was the British Army would be on Long Island when he got there. But by the time he got there, the British Army had already moved to Manhattan. So he made his way to Manhattan. He seems to have been able to gather information, as I say, copy down, whether it was troop placements or whatever, troop numbers, pieces of paper in Latin, and hide them in his shoes. Then he had made his way back to Long Island and was heading back to Connecticut when he was apprehended on Long Island, probably a day's distance away from what would have been safety.
And what happened to Hale after the British caught him trying to go back to his unit in Connecticut? How did he end up on the gallows?
He was a spy, and the punishment for a spy was execution. And the evidence against him apparently was so blatant that there was no court-martial or anything like that. He was brought to General Howe's camp and pronounced a traitor and the next day was hanged in the morning. And it's sort of interesting from this aspect of New England culture that he was hanged on the morning of the Sabbath.
Now, we have to know, did Nathan Hale really say those famous words we learned about in grade school? I mean, would you tell us more about his famous speech, or at least the speech he supposedly gave on the gallows, and whether or not he actually gave that speech?
Well, we don't know much other than when he was sent to the gallows, he was given a chance to speak. He made a few words about, as one often does, saying, well, your turn will come too, to his audience about death, and then supposedly said something along the lines of, I regret I have but one life to give for my country. Again, the evidence comes from retrospective accounts of people, again, William Hull in particular, mentioning this. We don't have absolutely direct evidence, although there are brief accounts by a couple of British officers that sort of hint that he said something along those lines. We also know he was familiar with the play Cato, which is the origins of the lines that he paraphrased. What I argue in the book is that he also knew when he chose those words, if indeed he did, and I think there's certainly a good chance that he did, he chose them in part because they would have been familiar to the British officers who would have known about this play, who were going to be pretty much the only audience for his execution. And they played a double role in that they obviously reflected American notions of patriotism and self-sacrifice, but also only gentlemen would have been familiar with this play, this literary work. And so he was at the same time establishing his political differences from the observers of his execution. He was establishing a common genteel character with them.
Okay, we should shift gears here and take a look at the life and experiences of Moses Dunbar. During the Revolution, Dunbar became a loyalist, or he remained a loyalist. Virginia, why do you think Dunbar remained loyal to the British Crown and Empire?
I think it has part to do with his Anglican faith. Again, with the monarch as the head of his church. I think that he disliked the disorder in his community, the sort of mob actions that were going on. At one point, I should mention here that the key source we have about Dunbar's ideas is something called his dying statement. It's essentially an autobiographical sketch of, you know, who he was, how he ended up where he was, and then briefly his thoughts on why he was on the eve of the gallows. And at one point he says that he did not think the differences between Britain and the colonies were worth shedding blood over. Now, this leaves open the question that he perhaps agreed with his patriot neighbors that the stamp tax was wrong, the tea tax was wrong, and so on. The coercive acts were wrong, but he didn't think it was worth shedding blood over. And I think the reason why he's executed is not only that he is a loyalist, but he joins a loyalist regiment to fight on Britain's behalf. And I think the reasons he's doing it are as much personal as political. He is persecuted in his hometown. As I say, he was beaten up, he was dragged to jail, and the jailer basically won't take him because he says there are no formal charges against him, but his neighbors suspect him. So what he ends up doing is going to Long Island after the British have taken New York and joins Edmund Fanning's Loyalist Regiment. He does so because, as he says, he's seeking a refuge for himself and his family outside of Connecticut. But also, when he gets there, he needs some sort of income. I mean, he's not going to own land in Long Island. It's not clear that he could get a job, but he's got a wife, a brand new wife, actually, and five kids. And so he can earn a salary from joining this loyalist regiment. Also, again, one of the things I try to stress in this book with the Hale and Dunbar stories is this is all happening in the fall of 1776, when any sane person in the colonies would think the British are about to win. So those are the contexts of their decisions, both Hale's and Dunbar's. And also there were rumors floating around that once the war was quickly over in Britain's behalf, those who supported Britain, who fought on Britain's side, could get land. And I suspect that if Dunbar heard such a rumor, he thought, okay, I joined this loyalist regiment, I have income for my family, potentially a landed estate down the road. Again, he also, you know, supports the British side, but there are these other personal reasons that can't be separated from the political ones.
Does the historical record tell us anything about why Dunbar chose to be a vocal loyalist? I mean, there were plenty of people who disagreed with the revolutionaries and who supported the crown while also keeping quiet about their views. But it really sounds like Moses Dunbar was under scrutiny by his neighbors and perhaps even by the local committee of safety for being outspoken about his views.
Definitely so. And why he speaks up, I don't know. He admits that he does. He admits in this dying statement that perhaps he was a little too public in his expressing his political views. He may have had a really cantankerous personality. I don't like psychologizing about people that I can't get more evidence about than I do for Dunbar. But if you put some of the pieces together, you know, this young man who has friction with his father, has to get married early while he's still in his teens, is trying to make a living, and then speaking up maybe where he shouldn't have, it does suggest something about a kind of combative personality, potentially.
Now, Dunbar joined the British Army so he could earn a salary to support his family. But what exactly did he do as a member of Fanning's Loyalist Regiment?
He doesn't do much of anything. He's a captain. He's commissioned as a captain. And he goes to Long Island, I believe, twice. And again, the records are pretty fragmentary and somewhat contradictory on this, but it looks like he goes two times and trains with this Loyalist regiment. There is an orderly book from somebody else who was in Fanning's King's American Regiment and suggests that much of what was going on was Fanning and his officers looking at this ragtag bunch of Loyalists, some of whom show up in camp wearing Continental Army uniforms because they've just changed their minds about which side they want to be on. There are instructions in this orderly book that these soldiers should cut their hair, they should get shoes, they should tuck in their shirts. So I think much of what Dunbar was doing is simply learning how to be a soldier and as a captain to command a small group of men, but he is never in combat. He never has any real military experience at all. He goes back to Connecticut to get his wife and children, and that's where he's caught before he's really contributed to this regiment.
And what about Dunbar's trials and last days in the hands of Connecticut's revolutionary government? Would you tell us about his trial and what happened?
Okay, he's captured right around January 1st, 1776. So as I say, I don't know that the news of the Battle of Trenton had reached Connecticut quite yet, but it's a time where everybody is petrified about the British winning. This is a particularly anxious time in Connecticut, because the British hold New York, which is the colony right on their border. And there were a lot of rumors of Loyalists in Connecticut helping the enemy, getting prepared for leading them into Connecticut and so on. And it's at this moment that Dunbar is captured by a local committee in his hometown and brought before the Superior Court. Now, one of the things that had been happening in Connecticut over the previous several months is the state had been passing successively harsher laws against helping the British, joining a Loyalist regiment or otherwise helping the British. And they passed a law in October of 1775 that made what Dunbar did, which is to say join a Loyalist regiment, a capital crime. And so he is captured a couple months later, and he's clearly guilty. I mean, he doesn't deny that he, you know, is in this regiment and that he was helping to recruit other people to join it. And I think the anxiety in Connecticut explains this trial in the Superior Court, but also that they wanted to demonstrate to people in Connecticut that this law on the books was not just words on paper. It meant something. Also, I think there are issues of sovereignty here. Prior to this period, treason was against the king. What we've got here in this law and other laws that are going to be passed in states as they become independent is a redefinition of treason against the state authority. And so this was, in effect, the government of Connecticut flexing its muscles, saying, okay, now we are a sovereign unit, and we can define and punish treason in our midst against the state of Connecticut. So he's put on trial. We have the indictment, and it's, you know, the fact that he's declared guilty. I wish we had testimony or whatever it is they had to go on. One of the pieces of evidence they did have was when he was arrested, he had on his person a receipt that listed his name and other people whom he had recruited to join the regiment. So it was hard evidence that he was involved in this.
In The Martyr and the Traitor, Virginia relates that we remember Nathan Hale as a martyr and Moses Dunbar as a traitor, because of the outcome of the revolution. She also notes that the stories of Hale and Dunbar serve to remind us of the common experience of the American Revolution and the Revolutionary War. Virginia, would you tell us more about how and why you think the stories of Nathan Hale and Moses Dunbar reveal a common experience of the American Revolutionary era?
I think that the way I would put it is that whichever side you chose, loyalism or patriotism, patriots and loyalists were made, not born. You weren't born into that position. Your political choice depended not just on a set of ideas, not on whatever social class you belong to, but a whole range of personal experiences. Again, in the case of Hale, had to do with his college friends and so on. Dunbar, his Anglican connections and his treatment at the hands of fellow patriots. So they tell us something about the complexity of motivations that could lead people whom you might otherwise think would make the same choice to make different ones. One piece of the story that I think we could pay more attention to, which is more relevant to the Dunbar stories than Hale, is my sense is Dunbar really wanted to be neutral. He supported the British, but he would rather have just kept his mouth shut. In fact, he says so at one point, just work on his farm and keep his nose down. And he's not allowed to. And he's not allowed to because he's asking for this treatment at the time the war has broken out. And war raises anxieties to a fever pitch. It increases partisanship, kind of a lesson for today in some ways, that it became a situation of you are either for us or against us. There's no middle ground. And I think a lot of people at the revolutionary era would have liked to occupy a middle ground.
Now it's time for the time warp. This is a fun segment of the show where we ask you a hypothetical history question about what might have happened if something had occurred differently or if someone had acted differently.
The time warp. Historians can't predict the future, but they can speculate about what might have been.
In the introduction to The Martyr and the Traitor, Virginia notes that when most scholars study loyalists, they tend to study the loyalists who left the United States. And as loyalist studies is a burgeoning field among scholars who study the American Revolution, I wonder, Virginia, in your opinion, what might we know or come to understand about the American Revolution if more historians took the time to study the loyalists who had stayed in the United States after the Revolution?
I have two thoughts on that. First is, when we think about the Revolution, we naturally think about the formation of a new nation. And there's a kind of an assumption that this political event was of great importance to the patriot side in the Revolution, that people really supported the creation of a new nation. Ultimately, we're going to argue over how it should be governed and so on, but that the Revolution created this new level of political affiliation, the American nation. I think when you look at loyalists who presumably you would think opposed the creation of that nation, if you ask why then, if they didn't like it, why they stayed, it suggests something else. It suggests a kind of continuity with the colonial period, which is to say that for most people, at least in that generation, their identification is not with a new nation state, not even with the state, but with their local communities and their families. When I looked at the descendants of Dunbar and some of his neighbors, you know, I asked myself, why would they stay in the same place? And I think it's family and community meant more to them ultimately than a national identity. The second thing that strikes me about looking at loyalists who stayed is sooner or later in various places, states created ways for loyalists to become citizens, either, you know, swear allegiance to the state, make conditions that they couldn't have actively fought against the state or whatever. But there are a number of ways to allow loyalists who remain to become citizens. And it strikes me as kind of interesting that the legal system creates ways to reincorporate enemies of the new state. And yet a number of peoples who fought on behalf of the revolution, such as certain Native American groups, most Native Americans fought against the revolution, but those who fought on the American side or African Americans who supported the American side were denied citizenship afterwards. And alas, I think one of the things we can think about as we look at the reincorporation of loyalists is the way in which this illustrates something that other historians are looking at in other ways, which is the way in which this new nation that emerges is one that is going to define citizenship on the basis of race as one of its criteria.
Now, your earlier work is focused on the 17th century, but The Martyr and the Traitor brought you into the 18th century. And I wonder, are you happy in the 18th century? I mean, will your next project focus on the 18th century, or are you thinking about going earlier again?
I am thinking about going earlier again. I'm at the very earliest stages of this, but I'm contemplating a Life and Times biography of a man named Daniel Gookin, who was an influential, one of these Atlantic figures of the early English Empire, involved in early Virginia, in Jamaica, and in New England.
If we have any lingering questions about Nathan Hale, Moses Dunbar, or common experiences during the Revolutionary War, how can we contact you to ask you our questions?
Probably the best way is through the University of Colorado History Department website. My email is listed there.
Virginia DeJohn Anderson, thank you for helping us explore the lives of Nathan Hale and Moses Dunbar and their experiences during the American Revolution.
Well, thank you.
No one was born a patriot or a loyalist. Patriots and loyalists were made by political and personal circumstances. And we can see this quite clearly when we look at the lives of Moses Dunbar and Nathan Hale. Moses Dunbar was a Connecticut farmer who looked to get ahead while he supported his young family. When the revolution broke out, it really seemed like Moses Dunbar wanted to remain neutral. As Virginia found, Dunbar actually stated that he didn't think the colony's differences with Great Britain were worth shedding blood over. But personal circumstances combined with some of his political sentiments to drive Moses Dunbar to support the loyalist cause. Local patriots, his neighbors, abused Dunbar. They harassed him for being a member of the King's Church, and they distrusted anything he said because of his church membership. This harassment grew to the point that even if Dunbar disagreed with imperial measures, he wasn't going to stand with his revolutionary neighbors because they had abused him so much. So Moses Dunbar joined Edmund Fanning's Loyalist Regiment because he needed to get out of Connecticut and into a new community, and he needed money and land to do both. Now, Dunbar may have heard rumors that the Crown would give its loyal supporters land in exchange for their service. And in 1776, it seemed like joining the British Army was a really safe bet. Plus, serving in a loyalist regiment would likely provide Dunbar with the opportunity he sought to fight back against his old abusive neighbors. Now, personal and political circumstances also drove Nathan Hale to support the revolutionary side of the conflict. Hale's college education ensured that he was steeped in the political literature and rhetoric of the day, while the social opportunities afforded by service in the Connecticut and Continental armies offered Hale a chance to reconnect with his old friends and relive some of the social experiences he had enjoyed at Yale. Together, the stories of Nathan Hale and Moses Dunbar reveal that for many Americans, politics and personal circumstances went hand in hand during the American Revolution. In fact, most Americans chose to give their allegiance to the side that offered them the best fit for both their personal circumstances and their political beliefs. You can find more information about Virginia, her book, The Martyr and the Traitor, plus notes for everything we talked about today on the show notes page, benfranklinsworld.com/181. Don't forget, we're meeting up at 4 p.m. on April 14 in Sacramento, California, and at 4 p.m. on April 21st in Las Vegas, Nevada. If you have any questions or need more details about these meetups, send me an email, liz@benfranklinsworld.com. I would be really grateful if you could spare me just a few minutes to take my listener survey, because I really want to hear from you. The link to the survey is benfranklinsworld.com/survey. Finally, what other personal factors do you think Americans considered when choosing their political loyalties during the American Revolution? There were so many diverse viewpoints and personal circumstances that must have factored into Americans' decisions. So I'm sure a lot of ideas haven't even occurred to me yet about why people chose the sides they did. So let me know what you think by sending me an email, liz@benfranklinsworld.com. Ben Franklin's World is a production of the Omohundro Institute.
And remember, never leave till tomorrow that which you can do today.